So Ruth's going to bring us up to date on Renew Wellbeing and speak to us. So let's just pray for you for a moment, please speak. Lord, we thank you for Ruth and all that she has given to this church and the road that she has set us on. We thank you for her now as she gives of her time to come and speak to us. And we pray that you will bless her, bless the preparation she's done, and give us ears to hear. Amen.
Amen. Oh, what a joy. Oh, look at you. It's like a homecoming, and none of you look any older, which is... Yeah, there. And you're supposed to say, and you don't either, Ruth. Absolutely lovely. I bring Mark's greetings to you as well. He's on the road to at our church, so isn't here with me, but would have loved to have been. And all the rest of the little Ricicles are around this weekend as well. So Elliot and Joy, and for those who remember them all, and Erin is living with us again. And Bradley sends his love particularly, and Pip, his girlfriend, who you won't have met yet, but has been to 37 and loves it, even though she definitely doesn't love church. She loves 37 and got some of her work people involved. So thank you guys at 37 for making her welcome, and our new granddaughter Layla. So I just have to introduce it. I wish she was here now so I could go like that, you know. Hey, you know that thing. I want to do that, but that was Lion King, by the way, in case you just thought I'd gone a bit mad. I bring you greetings from the family. We are so grateful to you. You still feel like our family. Thank you for your prayerful support for us. We've been able to work together in the same house for 2.5 years, and we're both still alive, so that's good. For those who know Mark and I, the charity is delightful. There isn't another word for it, and it makes me very emotional coming here, because standing here, oh man, we were in a different place, weren't we? But going, here's an idea, and you all went, oh, go on then. I mean, it was a little bit longer than oh, go on then, wasn't it? But you know, that's why it's important you have these church meetings and stuff, guys. Do go to it, because now I'm not a Baptist anymore. I really miss church meetings. Can you believe it? When you're Anglican, you don't get a chance to have any say whatsoever in anything that goes on. And you get to have a say. And you guys together decided that we would have a go at this little funny thing called Renew 37 7 years ago. And 7 years later, you are still turning up 4 days a week. And it's remarkable. It's remarkable what you're doing anyway. But here's... Is there a bit of music with this? No. Yeah. We'll have this in a minute, because actually I wanted to just watch this thing. Yeah, hang on to it a minute, because there's some really good picks coming up. But I want you to listen to it and just take a moment like I did when I was watching them. And know that what you started wasn't just, it is just for the one person who's come in and found peace. It's for you, Sue. It's for you. We are the project, aren't we? I mean, it was for us. It's quite a selfish thing. I needed it. I still do. And what's remarkable, though, is if I can tell you today, there are about 200 Renew spaces nationally, and there's 100 more in training. We've got 7 members of staff. It's one of those funny things, you know, where the little parable where it says in Mark 4, the farmer sows the seed and he wakes and he sleeps and it grows and he knows not how, that. And Mandy, pray for Mandy, look after Mandy, please look after Mandy. It's hard work administrating one charity. She's still administrating 2 until September. Sorry, Andy. I'm stealing her away from Good News Newspapers because there's so much work to do for Renew Wellbeing. But Mandy somehow manages to administrate that jelly up a hill that is, oh, there's another one. Oh, look, there's another one. And they're popping up and we're trying to sign people up well and keep them on track and make sure they're supported and that the thing doesn't whiz off into being something other than a prayer movement, because it is a prayer movement. And God is doing remarkable things. And people are getting saved and set free, but also feeling they belong somewhere. As a gentleman said to me the other day, he got hold of my hands, I was in North Allerton, and he went, I think I'm only alive because of this place. He found it the day after he tried to take his own life, and he said, I don't think I'm a Christian, but I really love that prayer thing they do. I like going to that all the time. And he just went on. Anyway, I said, I think maybe you are. And he went, yeah, I think maybe I am too. And it was just this kind of lovely, lovely, wonderful things happening. And I said, well, maybe the whole movement was just for you. It may be the... And every time I meet another one and another one, it's always for the one. So thank you. because the seed that is sown here is multiplying and multiplying. And here, I'd just like you to look at this, and then I'm going to bring you a bit of God's word. But please pray for us, because you're going to see different centres popping up, and you're going to see the team. And because there's a lot of work, and pray for our dear trustees, some of whom are here. I mean, Carl's going to step down from being a trustee. Carl, we love you. Thank you so much for getting us started. Pray for somebody to replace Carl, who's also got his skill set, because he's done all our contracts and we haven't got anyone. And pray for the trustees, because at the end of this month, I'm going to be asking them to take a massive faith leap to double our output, practically, in terms of our staff, without knowing where the funding's coming from. It's always how the charity's grown, I'm afraid. You know that. You know that, those of you who were here when I led you through the time of setting up Renew 37. We did it, and then God provided the money. Renew Wellbeing's no different. We do it, and then God provides. So this is key growth time for the charity, and I'm glad I'm here to say to you, please keep praying for us. I want you to watch this and look at it and just pray as you're watching it, if you like, and a piece of music that I love, and it just makes me really grateful for you, and then I'll bring you a little word from the Bible. So have a look at this.
Of the goodness of God.
Just as the last few are scrolling, Lord, we thank you so much for what you are doing, renewing well-being, and I bless from the bottom of my heart this lovely fellowship here at New Life for their obedience to you when it wasn't a thing, to step out into the unknown, to pave the way for others, and to keep going. Would you bless this church, the team at 37, with just such a blessing now, such a big smile of your face on them, to know what it is they're doing, what they're part of. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Did you see my favourite there? Renew with a brew. That's up in Yorkshire. That's great, isn't it? Renew with a brew. Let me just bring you won't be at all surprised. In fact, by the way, if you've not seen A to Z of Wellbeing yet, it came out. That's what the pandemic was for, obviously, so I could write two books. I didn't think I was going to write books, but it passed the time. So if you've never had a hold of Slow Down, Show Up and Pray, you're in that all over the place. You're very welcome to have this. If you've not had this book yet, you're welcome to have this one to take away with you. Just come and ask me for it afterwards. And A to Z of Wellbeing, because I'm fascinated by the subject of well-being, I can't get to the bottom of it. I can't define it in one sentence. That's 26 ways in which I'm trying to live it. And there's some questions and some things that might help you deepen your study. And in September, there's going to be sort of 52 little videos that St Andrew's Bookshop are going to do as a big church read for a year of well-being based on the A to Z of well-being. You could use in small groups, so you're very welcome to that. Again, if you've not seen a copy of that and you'd like this one, just come and have it. You can ask me for it. It's yours. So let's look at the proper book, the best one. This is... do you know, if I could take a little straw poll, I said to my Erin this morning, what do you think I'm going to preach on today? And she went, breakfast on the beach. I went, yes! She knows it. I know you've all heard me preach on this before. Sorry, for the three people who've never heard me preach, this is probably my favourite resurrection story of all time. In fact, maybe my favourite Jesus story of all time. So I have to just bring it to you again. And also because I tried to think of something more clever and God wouldn't let me, so we're doing this. So in case you haven't seen it, we're looking at John 21. I'd love to read this with you. I'm going to read some chunks of it. And this is Jesus after he's risen from the dead. I'm sorry if you've just had this preached to you, but I'm doing it again. And then he appears to Mary Magdalene. He appears to the disciples. He appears to Thomas, who's doubting him. You know that story. And then you've got Simon Peter, who's, you know, let him down. And he's really fed up and tired and weary and disappointed. And so he decides to go back to what he used to do. Is this ringing any bells with anybody? I feel like we've had the worst couple of years that we could never have expected. And now we're all bouncing back with masks on and trying to do what we did before. And for some of us, it's not working. And it might be fine. And it was wonderful worshipping with you this morning. But I'm telling you, I'm working with hundreds of churches out there and we're not okay. We're not immune from the fact we've just been through a global pandemic. Our churches are not filling up with... You look fairly healthy in number here, but lots of churches are finding it really hard to get back to whatever normal was supposed to be. Our young people are not ploughing their way back in. And many folk who've had time to think whether church has a place in their life are deciding it didn't. And so there's a problem. We've got a problem. And even though we know that Jesus is alive, like Peter does, some of us have tried to go back to what we did before, and it's not working. I feel like this is a really timely passage for all of us. There's only one church, and we're part of it. So if one church is struggling, we're all struggling. And that's before we talk about the global sort of still a pandemic in terms of mental health. So if I talk about that for a moment, the latest statistic around young people's mental health is that 47% of young people of a certain age said they feel more stressed now than they ever have in their lives. So that's like half of our young people feeling more stressed than they've ever stressed than they've been in their lives. I think there's some issues. I'm not trying to depress you here. Just be realistic, because this, I think, is good news for us today. So here we've got him, beginning of chapter 21. Just the context, Simon Peter, he's let Jesus down. He's gone back to what he does. He says to his friends, I'm going fishing. They say, verse 3, we'll go with you. Verse 4. Oh, and by the way, they go out on the lake and they catch nothing. The thing they knew how to do before they followed Jesus, that didn't work. So just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, verse 4. Yet the disciples didn't know it was Jesus. And Jesus said, children, do you have any fish? And they said, no. Can you imagine that? No, we haven't got any fish. And he said to them, all night they've been fishing. Like, you got any fish? No. Cast the net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. Now the disciple whom Jesus loved, by the way, that's the disciple who's writing this book. The disciple who Jesus loved, that'll be me, said to Peter, the one that is always getting it wrong, it's the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work. He threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, doing all the work, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, about 100 yards off. When they got to the land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. And Jesus said, bring some of the fish you've caught. So Simon Peter went aboard, hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153. Somebody took time to count them. And although there were so many, the net wasn't torn. And Jesus said, come and have breakfast. Now, none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? For they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came, he took the bread, he gave it to them, and so with the fish. Now, this is the third time that Jesus is revealed to the disciples when he's raised from the dead. When they'd finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And he said, yes, Lord, you know I love you. So this is Peter, who's denied he knows Jesus three times whilst Jesus is being flogged. He stood out there and gone, no, I don't follow him, with expletives probably. He says a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he says, yes, Lord, you know I love you. He said, tend my sheep. And then he says a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was grieved because he'd said it three times. Do you love me? And he said, you know everything, so you know I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Then he tells him how he's going to die. Not so much fun. Or that he's going to get old and be led around. But this passage here, I think, is really key. And just for a couple of minutes, I want to tell you why. I think it's key for you guys. I think it's key for me. I think it's key for the charity. And I think it's pretty much key for the world, really. Because this is the kindness of the gospel. Did you know that in the church calendar, and by the church, I mean the other bits of the church that have an actual calendar that they follow, this is Julian of Norwich Day. Did we know this? So Julian of Norwich was not actually called Julian. They sort of named them after different things, didn't they? But she was a, what do they call them, anchoress. So during a time of Black Death pandemic, where 60% of the UK population was completely wiped out in the first one, and then 10 years later, another 20%, Julian of Norwich felt called to be an anchoress, which meant she just prayed all the time, stayed in a room and prayed all the time. I mean, pretty much if the Black Death was out there, I don't think that's too surprising, really. But on the 8th of May, nearly 700 years ago, Jesus showed up to her. And she had a series of these amazing encounters with God. And she's one of the first, well, she is, I think, the first woman ever to be quoted in print, ever. She's like the Shakespeare of women of the church, if you like. And this is one of the things that God revealed to her and she wrote down. And it's a prayer. God of your goodness, give me yourself. You are enough for me. Anything less that I could ask for would not do you full honour. And if I ask anything that is less, I shall always lack something. But in you alone, I have everything. We just all prayed that and sang that, didn't we, this morning? You know, when David prayed, I was like, oh, I'm about to read this. You are enough for me. God of your goodness, give me yourself, for you are enough for me. If you forget everything else I'm about to say, have a look at Julian of Norwich afterwards. Because what I want to say to you is, all I've discovered about well-being is, he is enough for us. So first thing that Jesus does, one of the first things, after there's these, you're just picturing it, aren't you? Disappointment, and we haven't even caught any fish, and now I don't understand it, and I've let Jesus down, and here he is, and I'm feeling a bit embarrassed, and I can't even do what I used to be able to do. And he's standing on the shore, and he says, come and have breakfast. These are my favourite four words in the Bible almost. Come and have breakfast. This is why I follow Jesus. One of the main reasons is he's the sort of God who cooks you breakfast when you're disappointed and you've let him down. He doesn't beat you up. He doesn't tell you to try harder. This is the gospel. This is the gospel that I heard when I'm lying in my bed watching reruns of Dallas, unable to get up, unable to look after my family because I was too depressed. This is the God who said to me, Ruth, I couldn't love you anymore. I'll never love you any less. This is the gospel that we don't earn it. You can sit there and still be sitting there at the end of your life, and he will still love you just as much if you do nothing for him. If you help no one, God will not love you any more or any less, because he can't, because he loves you completely. He is enough for you, of himself. That's the gospel. I grew up with a gospel of God wants to use you for the kingdom. That word use, I'm sick of it. If you've read my book, you'll know that, because it says we are not a spatula. I just think there's something about the beauty of the gospel that says, okay, so you're disappointed and you're trying to do what you did before and it's not working. Any other God might have left us to go, well, we've had our run. We've had a good run. You've had a good time, Peter, and now it's time for me to move on and save the rest of the world. No, Jesus takes time out in his resurrection schedule of only a few weeks to go and cook breakfast for his friend who's disappointed and fed up when it's not working anymore. If that's you, and you're disappointed and fed up and church isn't working anymore and life isn't quite what it was, he's not far off. Can you smell the fish? He's come to you. He's not waiting for you to come to him. He finds you in your place of disappointment and he cooks breakfast for you. Who would not want to follow this saviour? What's that look like for you? Can you smell the bread cooking? I don't know about you, but I am. I think it's because I'm not here, but I find church quite tricky, having done 2 years of not going. And we've got too many people at ours, can you believe? And I'm a bit like, oh, I don't want to be too near everybody. And, oh, is it over yet? When am I going to watch Netflix? It's not going to watch itself. And I get that kind of flabby social muscle that means that normally I just switch a screen off after an hour and people go away. And now I've got to stay and talk to them a bit longer. It's tough. I'm a bit weary from these last 2 years. Are you? And Jesus is there and he's cooking us breakfast. It's not the end. It's the beginning of a new chapter. So the kindness of Jesus. Secondly, he also says, just before that, in fact, he says, bring some of the fish you've caught. How weird's that? Have you thought about how weird that is? Here's Jesus. He's got fish and he's got bread. It says they're already cooking on the fire. He needs nothing else. And yet, he asks Peter to bring some of the fish that he has caught, and he doesn't even need them. I fully believe one of the things I've discovered through this movement is he wants what you've got in your hand. However pathetic you think it is, however little you think it is, however unnecessary you think it is, however much you think God's got it cornered with everybody else's gifts, he wants what you carry. He made you on purpose with a load of gifts, and it's not full and complete the picture without you. I think the whole thing of where Jesus goes, have you got any fish? He could have just gone, never mind, boys, come in, I've got some here. Doesn't do that. He shows them, he does something miraculous, he does something different. Maybe that's a word to the church, like the whole church. It's like, it's not over, it's just beginning. Throw your nets on the other side. What does that look like for you, New Life, to throw your nets on the other side? Because I don't think it's over, and I don't think he's waiting for the bigger churches to get all the fish, and I don't think it's the end of young people and children at little churches in the suburbs. I don't. I really don't. Because our kids are not okay, and we're meeting here in a school, and I think there's something new that might happen if we chuck our nets on the other side, and I don't even know what I'm saying, and I didn't plan to say that, but I think it's going to happen. And one of the things that we as a charity fully believe is now's the right time for us to push forward with the Children, Youth and Family Renews that are starting. We've got 7 in schools, but we're going to need to put Sarah's time. Sarah Fagredo, some of you know, is our Children, Youth and Family Coordinator and developing some lovely ways of doing Renew with young people to help churches that don't have youth workers, that have only got older people and a few, you know, they think they can't manage it. I think we can be present to our children and young people, can't we? So, little extra aside there, co-producing. We talk about this in mental health terms. God wants to co-produce with us. He wants what you've got. He wants what you carry. He wants what breaks your heart. He wants what you've been praying about. He wants your funny little gift, your tiny few loaves and couple of fish that you think maybe have gone a bit out of date. It's not finished with you. I don't think there is any retirement. I was just praying with Mike earlier on. I'm praying more now, Mike, than you were 5 years ago when we last prayed together. Because like Ajit Fernando, head of Sri Lanka Youth for Christ, used to say, if prayer's the best thing we can do when it's all we can do, it's a promotion. Prayer's the best thing we can do. It is. So co-producing with us, co-producing with what you've got. If what you've got is the ability to sit home and pray, thank you. Pray with all your heart, because right now is a time to be prayerful. And then thirdly, what else does Jesus say here that blows my mind about well-being? Because firstly, the gospel is kind. Secondly, we co-produce with him. Thirdly, it's about complete surrender. I'm learning this the hard way. So we get to verse 15, breakfast's going on, and then he says, Peter's thinking, got away with it. Maybe he didn't notice I denied him three times. And he says, Simon Peter, Simon son of John, do you love me more than these? Now, what are the these? Lots of discussion. Could have been the fish, could have been the fishing, could have been the other disciples, could have been anything. To be honest, it doesn't matter what it was, but do you love him the most? I'm saying it to you too, to me. God keeps saying it to me. Do you love me more than Renew Wellbeing? Do you love me more than whether this works or not? Do you love me more than your family, more than your little granddaughter? Do you love me more than these? He'll have us all. He wants all of us. I don't think it's because he's greedy. I think it's because what he has to give us back when our hands are empty is so much better than what we carry. And very often he gives us back to carry the very things we gave to him. But we can carry them with our hands open rather than tight. This is the stuff of a lifetime of learning for me. As a born worrier, you know that. Keeping my hands open when I'm praying for my kids, when I'm trying to work out what to do next with the charity, going, well, it's up to you, Lord. That stuff of emptiness, that complete surrender, it's not sacrifice, is it, to give back to him what we cannot keep, to gain what we cannot lose. Complete surrender. Do you love me more than these? Do you? I wonder what's the thing that you wake up thinking about in the morning and the last thing you think about at night. That helps me to know what am I surrendered to. Very often it's a worry about one of my kids or whatever. I want it to be him for himself because he is enough for me. And that takes practice every morning. That's why we do morning prayer, we do evening prayer, we do midday prayer. Because as we practice his presence, he becomes enough for us. It's not that we don't still love our families. It's not that we don't still have other stuff in our minds. It's that they need to orbit around him because he is enough for us. Do you love me more than these? And lastly, once we've realised the kindness of Jesus, we're co-producing with Jesus, we're completely surrendered to Jesus, then he gets the bit, feed my sheep, tend my lambs, feed my sheep. It'd be lovely, wouldn't it, if we could just go, so there's few people coming to Renew 37, that's great. Now we've got 200 other centres. Hooray, written the book, sign off. There's never going to be a sign off for me, I don't think, because I always hear the other little lamb that bleats. There's always a story of somebody who says, nobody knows my name. Nobody knows who I am. And whilst that happens, God keeps breaking my heart for the next one. I want to go, enough already, Lord. To 200 centres, will that not do? No. Until on every corner, this is the vision he gave me, until on every street corner, there's a place where people can be welcomed. Until there's nobody saying, no one knows my name. I'm going to keep going for it. I think the compassion of Jesus that melts your heart is a bit annoying sometimes, really, because you'd like to have a nice, quiet life. You go, I've done that now. I've done it. I wrote a book about it. So now I would like to sit and watch some telly and put my feet up. But there's always another one. He's the good shepherd. We're part of this flock, and there's always room for another one, and another one, and another one. And until everybody knows they are known by name and not by label, until everybody feels they've got a place where they belong, it's never going to be enough for me. You can call me greedy if you like, and probably that is true. What is it that the compassion of Jesus melts your heart for? Because once he shows you something, once he shows you what his heart is broken for, it's very hard to unsee it and very hard to unhear it. So I'm saying that because I'd love for you to pray with me that the thing that you started doesn't stop with one or two. Even across West Bridgeford, there are 14 churches, that this multiplies into spaces where people are sitting behind closed doors with nobody to talk to. For every young person who thinks that the only way that they'll get attention is to hurt themselves, there needs to be a place where they know that they are loved anyway. And whilst that is the case, God's people have got some work on their hands, and we're tired and we're weary and we need his restoration and we need the breakfast and we need to come daily and let him feed us, and our own fish won't do, and we're going to need to fish on the other side of the boat and he's going to give us resources we've never had before, and there's always one more, and he'll show maybe you the one person. It might be your neighbour, it might be someone in your family that you'd stopped praying for because you've given. Don't give up. This is a don't give up story, because we're about to get the best bit of the story coming, where Jesus actually ascends into heaven and goes, better is coming. Holy Spirit dwelling in us. There's that same power that raised Jesus from the dead in us, the church. New life, it's just beginning. Renew 37 is a good chapter in your story. It's one chapter. There's more. I'm so delighted he sent you Paul and Julie. I'm so delighted. And my prayer for you is that you will keep coming to him and know he is enough for you, and that he will break your hearts for what is going on that is always beyond you. The kindness of Jesus, co-producing with Jesus, complete surrender to Jesus, compassionate call to follow Jesus. This is my little prayer for you. It's under V is for values. This is a rewriting of a blessing. May he who truly loves you bless you to know that it's okay not to be okay. In fact, it's the only way to open hands and doors and plans, to see the new within the old, that there's more blessing than our churchy little boxes could hold. And may the Lord keep you in tension of lament and praise, keep you not knowing how many days we have, keep you outside your careful church-based plan, keep you applauding in your streets for your fellow man. And may the Lord make his face shine on you, and may it shine right through you. And may the things that you thought were you get caught up in the blaze of his shining face. And may he give you peace. Not happy moments for the few who made it to the meetings who already knew his peace, but deep shalom that joins the many and seeks the one who cries alone. Peace, shalom, well-being spoken, blessing given. May his kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, I thank you so much for this lovely, lovely church, for the very real sense of your presence here and the beauty of their obedience to you and pouring themselves out. But Lord, there's breakfast cooking. And for those who are disappointed in you, in themselves, even in church, would you just wake up our olfactory senses now, Lord, so we can smell what's cooking. We can hear your voice calling us back to you, asking us to bring what we carry. Breathing your Spirit's life over us again. Oh, the kindness of Jesus. He's coming to us now. And Lord, where we need to completely surrender to you, where there's other things that we love more than you, help us be a bit more honest about that. Until we love you more than all else. And you are enough for us. Give us habits in our lives that we can share with others. Lord, renew well-being in our day, in our time, in our lives, in our families, in this nation and beyond. Because there's always one more who needs you, Jesus. Teach us to follow you again. Help us fall in love with you again. Cook breakfast for us, Lord, please. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're following what's happening with Renew Wellbeing, please do. If you ever want to join us for morning prayer, you can get an email from me once a week on a Monday morning. Just let me know if you want to join in, and we open a Zoom room. And if you're not able to get down to 37 because you're at home or whatever, you can join in with morning prayer on Zoom, and it's rather lovely every morning. So keep praying, and thank you so much for who you are. Bless you.
Thank you, Ruth.